weakest moment I see you shaking your head in disgrace. I can read the disappointment written all over your face. Here come those whispers in my ear saying, who do you think you are? Looks like you're on your own from here. Cause grace could never reach that far. But in the shadow of that shame, beat down by all the blame, I hear you call my name, saying it's not over. And my heart starts to beat so loud, now I'm drowning out the doubt. I'm down but I'm not out. There's a a thirsty soul, the broken side begins to heal, and grace returns what guilty stole. And they're fighting for
Well, good to see you this morning. Why don't you stand and join with us as we begin our hearts in worship today? Stand and sing, won't you?
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed.
If you're glad he's Lord, say amen.
Up, stand up.
Today, and glad you're here in God's house. Give me a little more mic, guys. Glad you're in God's house today, and aren't you glad you can stand up for Jesus? Amen. And I'm glad today we have the victory in Jesus. Some of those are some of my favorite hymns that we still can claim the power and the promises of them. And so, man, welcome to New Life Church. We're excited about what God has in store for us today. At the end of our service this morning, we've got a baptism. We're going to get to baptize 9 or 10 young people today that have given their heart to the Lord. And nothing thrills my soul more than being able to baptize somebody who's doing it in obedience to God's command for those that are Christian. And so we're excited about that at the end of the service, and then excited about preaching God's word. So thank you for being here. If you're visiting with us for the first time, or maybe it's been a long time since you've been at New Life Church, as our ushers make their way to the back, would you lift up your hand high enough for them to see it? And they've got a card and a pen they'd like to give to you. Fill the card out, drop it in the offering plate when it comes by in just a few moments. We just want that as a record of your visiting with us. You're our honored guest today, and we love visitors at New Life Church. Amen? Amen. Amen. So make sure you come back and see us, and make sure you just settle in, make yourself at home, and let's worship the Lord together. Can we pray together this morning? Father, it is a joy to be in the house of God today. Lord, we count it a privilege to worship you in spirit and in truth. And we pray that you would do something today of a radical nature in our midst. Thank you for the victory that we have in Jesus Christ, and for the promise that we have where two or three are gathered in agreement in your name, that you're going to be right in the midst. And so we're looking forward to what you have in store for your people today. May there be a freedom. May there be an anointed spirit in this service. Bless the choir now as they sing. Lord, use it to challenge us about the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Made of wood, built by man, there it stood, salvation's plan. Adam's fall and my own sin, it was all placed on
of Calvary. Amen. 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 Why don't you stand up, turn around, greet those who are next to you. If a visitor standing beside you, make them feel welcome this morning. So glad that you're in worship today. Choir's going to go down and we're going to sing again in just a second. Thank you for being here. Won't you sing with us?
Every praise is to our God, every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Every praise today is to our God, and He is worthy of that praise. Amen. Amen. It's good to see all of you here. Thank you for being here. Great July 31st crowd, and some of you are here for baptism, and I know that means a lot to the one being baptized, and so thank you for being here today, and thank you for what you give. We try to be a good steward of what is given by God's people. I believe that's our responsibility, but we pray today that you will give again sacrificially, out of a heart of worship, that you'll give cheerfully and as unto the Lord, because God has been so good to us. Amen. Amen. It's good to have all of you here. Good to have my folks here. My mom and dad are here today, and I'm going to ask my dad if he will to lead us in prayer. Maybe see.
Storms may come, storms may go, the pain may linger like melting snow. The winds may toss you to and fro, but He'll hold you through it all.
He'll hold you
when the tempest rages all around.
He'll hold you.
Plant your feet.
Up upon life's shore, but He'll hold. storm.
He'll hold you when the tempest rages all around. He'll hold you, plant your feet on solid ground. He'll hold you when the waves come crashing down. He will hold you.
We have a rock that's called my Savior. I tell you what, I'm glad we have somebody we can turn to in rough times, aren't you? Sunday school lesson this morning, when the brothers came and Joseph revealed himself and they didn't know who he was. He shared, "I'm your brother Joseph." And they were wondering how they were going to make it, how they were going to survive with the famine in the land. And God provided. God made a promise to those people back when Abraham was living, that your people will live, and God was going to take care of his folks. He'll hold you in the times of the storm. He'll provide for you in a time of doubt, in a time of struggle. When he died on the cross, he did that for us. He made a way for us to find him, to come to him, and ask him to forgive us of our sins because of the cross and the blood that was shed on Calvary. And he came out of that grave victorious. What a great day that was. Let's stand together and continue worship today. Let's sing this together.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he.
The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him on Calvary's mountain, one day they die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is. and took the nails for me.
We look forward to that day when you'll come, when you'll split the eastern sky, whenever you will send for us, your church, your children, your family. And Lord, we'll be with you forever in heaven. Lord, we have that day to look forward to. And God, thank you for the price, the payment that was made for us to have that expectation. Lord, we ask now that you'll help us to listen to what you have to say to us from your word. It's been great. It's been fun, awesome to sing this morning. But Lord, now we want to hear from you. Be with the preacher now as he comes. Give him the power and the words that we need to hear from your word today. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you for the great worship this morning. Take your Bibles, turn to the book of Hebrews, chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, want to jump right into the message because we do have the baptism after I get done preaching, whenever that may be, right? Are you looking for that glorious day? You sang like you are, so that's exciting. But man, we're just honored that you're here. And today's sermon is going to take something special from you in order for God to do with it what he needs to do. Number one, it's going to take some humility. And then number two, it's going to take some honesty. On the surface, they sound like they would be pretty easy things to inject into a Baptist service. But I'm afraid that many times when we come, we do not come near as honest as we should or as humble as we should. And so I'm praying, and has been my prayer this morning, that as you humble yourself and get honest with yourself, I will humble myself and get honest with myself, and I believe God will do something special in our hearts. From Hebrews chapter 2. Begin reading in verse number 1. The Bible says, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard. Now, what things would you suppose they were? Well, in its direct context, the writer of Hebrews is talking about what he had written in the first chapter. Thus, using the word therefore, it was a bridge word to say, in light of those things that I've taught you, we're not sure who the author is, whether it was Paul. There's a possibility. There's a lot about the book of Hebrews that sounds Pauline-esque, but I'm not sure Paul was the penman. Whether it was Apollos, whether it was Luke, we're just not sure. Maybe it was just the Holy Spirit of God. We don't know. What we do know is it's inspired, and the message in Hebrews is for you and me today. And so he's saying, in light of what I have just written, in light of the doctrines that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, and if you believe that, say amen. In light of that, you need to earnestly take heed to the things that you've heard. And then notice what he says. Lest that at any time we should let them slip away. If I were to put signs, and forgive me for not getting them on the screen in time, but I don't believe I have to show them for you to at least recognize them. There's a lot of warning signs that we see on a daily basis. For instance, if you've ever gone to play golf with some of our guys in our church, you understand that there's much more terrain than just the golf course itself. And so you might see a sign that says, warning, beware of dog. I saw one sign that had a big German shepherd on the sign, and it said, don't make me mad, I'm running out of space for bones. Warning, beware of dogs. Maybe you've seen the signs on the road, state sign that says, warning, it says, men at work. Or warning, high voltage. Look at that guy. That's one I don't have, but I should put that one up there. Watch out for snakes. How many of you are like me? You hate a snake. Raise your hand. God bless you. That's the elect right there. The rest of you like the devil just a little too much. Warning, school crossing. Warning, slippery floor. Warning, road work ahead. Warning, children at play. Or maybe being this close to the coast, you've seen this one. Warning, strong undertow. Swim at your own risk. See, circumstances like the following account have been repeated over and over and over again. Two young men were fishing above a low dam on a river near their hometown. As they were concentrating on catching fish, they were unaware that they had drifted away from their fishing spot until they were not too far from the water flowing over the dam. When they realized their situation, the current near the dam had become so powerful that there was no way to get their boat back to shore. Thus, they both, with their boat, went over the side of the dam, plummeting to their deaths by the strong force of the impact of the great boulders and the water above them. They died because they drifted. And just like the physical warnings that we see, we also have in the Scriptures spiritual warnings. This in the book of Hebrews is the first warning passage of this book. And yet it gives us a very stern warning that we both need to be
humble toward, and honest with. It's sad to say this morning, but it is not uncommon for Christians to drift. In fact, if we were to be honest, there may be many here today that if you were to go back to the time in your Christian life where you were the hottest for God and you were on fire for Him and you had the greatest hunger for His Word and the deepest prayer life and the greatest burden for souls, that time and today would be two different times. And if we're not careful, we will look back to the shore and realize we've drifted a long way. We've been caught up in the undertow. This week in studying this passage, Alexander McLaren, who was a world-famous preacher and a great expositor of the Scriptures, he wrote this about Hebrews 2:1. He said of the words, "Let them slip," he says, "they convey a vivid picture of a man holding some treasure with limp fingers and allowing it to drop from his nerveless grasp." He said, "As striking as the picture is, the one which is really expressed by the original is the one of a vessel or a ship, not slipping away, but drifting away," which the Revised Version translated this, that we need to earnestly heed those things, lest at any time we drift away from them. He said, drifting should be something we should fear. It was George Guthrie who sums up these various nuances in terms. He says, "The image of drifting is an especially potent one. The word used here could signify objects slipping away, such as a ring that slips off of a finger, or an object that goes in the wrong direction," which all of us can relate to this, as a piece of food would go down the wrong pipe. But Guthrie says, "Perhaps the image that closely identifies the intentions of the writer would be the ship that has drifted ever so slightly from the harbor because of the strong current of the water or the slight breeze of the wind." R. Kent Hughes defines drifting in practical terms. He says, "The church has experienced for 2,000 years this intersect." He said, "I believe that drifting is the besetting sin of the 21st century church. Christians neglect their anchor, which is Jesus Christ, and we begin to quietly drift away from Him. No friction, no dramatic sense of departure, just a slight ease away from God." He uses Ephesus in the book of Revelation chapter 2 as an example when Jesus went to this church, riding through the Apostle John, and a church that had great labor and a church that had experienced great success and a church that held to great zeal. And yet Jesus writes to them and says, "I have somewhat against thee. I have aught against thee." Why? He says, "Because you have forsaken," or "you have drifted away from your first love." We see this danger all throughout the Scriptures. One of my favorite passages, a passage that I quote many times when I preach, is Psalm 1, where the Bible says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth at the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in that law doth he meditate day and night." And the Bible describes that person as a person, a man that shall be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water, that will bring forth fruit in this season. His leaf, the Bible says, will not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. But notice verse 4, the Bible says, "But the ungodly," those that are not like God, "are not so, but are like a chaff," the seed covering, the useless light seed covering, "which a slight breeze can drive away." Do you understand this morning that drifting and being caught up in the undertow is a satanic work?
Jesus told Simon in Luke chapter 22, verse 31. He said, Simon, Simon, behold, the Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. It's the same work. It's a drifting away from God. And I know what you're thinking here, because this is New Life Church. This is Sunday morning. This is game time. You're good Christians. You're great people. And you're saying, that'll never happen to me. What's funny about that is that's exactly what Peter said to Jesus. The very next verse, Peter said, Lord, I know you're God and all, but you must be mistaken. Because I would never allow Satan to sift me away from the fold. And Jesus said, Peter, he said, before the cock crows three times, you're going to deny me three times. All of us can drift. Every single one of us, if we have not experienced it in our life, maybe it's because we just haven't opened our eyes and looked, but all of us can be caught up in the undertow. The Apostle Paul many times cautioned his readers while he cautioned himself. Like in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27, when he said, I keep under my body, I bring it into subjection. You remember when we studied that passage, he was saying that I give myself the knockout punch. I punch myself under the eye. I give myself the knockout punch, and then I put myself into slavery and drag myself to Jesus. He said, I keep under my body. I put it into subjection, lest by any means that when I have preached to others, I myself would be a castaway. It's the drift. It's the undertow. You may be here this morning and you say, well, preacher, what causes the undertow? What causes us to drift? Well, let me just submit two things to you, then I'll get to our passage. First of all, I believe that we can drift. And I believe these are seen, maybe just not reading between the lines, but just implied here in our passage, where you can drift if you get preoccupied by something other than God. When we get preoccupied by something other than God, I put on my notes, preoccupied by worldly things. I'm not necessarily just saying sinful things, but I will say this, that anything that preoccupies your focus from being on God is a worldly thing. Whether that's your house or your car, your family or your job, the money that you have or the money that you don't have. Being preoccupied by something that is not God many times will result in us drifting away from Him. But secondly, another cause of drifting, and this one is really implied in the text, is an unconscious neglect of heavenly things. Have you ever neglected something and you didn't mean to? Like, when was the last time you went into your closet, and we just did this yesterday at my house, and you said, man, I got to clean this thing out. How did it get like this? Or guys, when's the last time you went in your garage and you're like, what happened? Or ladies, maybe you walked into the washroom and there were 8 loads of clothes there, and you're like, who dumped all of this in here today? Not realizing that it happens over time. Those that have lots of kids are laughing because that's every day, right? When we unconsciously neglect heavenly things. That's why he was encouraging them to give a more earnest heed. There's two things I know about drifting. Number one, drifting requires no effort. I don't have to do a thing to drift away from God. It's what comes natural. I mean, just stop oaring. Stop tacking against the wind. Your boat's going to drift. The same is true for the Christian, that we must give an earnest heed. Why? Because if we just stop everything, we're going to drift away. We know that we don't have to do anything. It takes no effort to drift. And then number two, it's an unconscious process because of the undercurrent. Stephen Cole said this. He said, the danger that the writer of Hebrews was confronting was this, in relative terms. You are either drifting with regard to your salvation because of neglect, or you are growing because of a deliberate effort and attention. It's one or the other. It's not both, it's not neither. You're growing or you're drifting. And I believe in our passage today we have two warnings, two specific undertows that are dragging the people of God away from the safety of Jesus Christ. I want to address them quickly with you from our text today. Notice undertow number one that we need to guard against. We must guard against the undertow of false doctrine. We must guard against the undertow of false doctrine. I find that people believe just about anything, and they do it quickly these days. People believe false philosophies about God's truth. They use philosophies in their daily life that are not biblical, and then when they get in a pickle, as it were, they blame it on God because of what they put their faith and foundation on. It was Paul that wrote to the church of Ephesus when he was saying, this is why God has given you pastors and teachers and apostles and prophets. The reason God has given those to you, so that you would not be henceforth children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. You say, well, I don't need the local church. Let me tell you what happens to a person that withdraws himself from the preaching of God's word and the fellowship with God's people. You are a prime candidate for false doctrine. You're going to be a child. You're going to be tossed to and fro. Before you know it, you're going to find yourself in the drift and caught up in the undertow. What false doctrines are we actually talking about? Well, let me give you three of them. Three of them in our culture that are prevalent in good churches like ours. And some of these may come as a surprise, but it's absolutely true. We must guard against the undertow of this false doctrine, the doctrine that says there's more than one way to heaven. You say, well, preacher, do we really combat that? I can say this with confidence, that there's not a week that goes on in my life that I do not confront somebody that believes, claims to be a Christian, but believes in multiple ways to heaven. This week, two people sat in my office and did not believe that Jesus was the only way to heaven, but they claimed to be a Christian. Let me make it abundantly clear today. I believe based upon the foundation of God's inspired, infallible, and inerrant word that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. Amen. The only way. For by grace are you saved through faith, the Son of works, lest any man should boast. The Mormons cannot earn their way there. They have to go through Jesus. The Muslims cannot get there by a false god, neither can the Buddhists. They must go. If they're getting to God, they have to go through Jesus. It was Jesus, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, that said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And yet, if we get soft on that doctrine, before we know it, we are going to be swept in by the undertow of false doctrine. Multiple ways to heaven. Number two, the doctrine of loose grace. If you want to be New Testament about it, lasciviousness, but you can't spell that, so loose grace. Unbridled lust. Claiming to be saved because of some commitment that you made or some prayer that you said or some pamphlet that you read or some altar experience that you have, and then you think you can leave and live any way you want to. God does not let us live any way we want to. This one is sweeping across the church. Many churches or organizations are growing because you can come as you are, and they say you can stay as you are. My fear, ladies and gentlemen, as I've said many times, is that you are going to die as you are, lost. The doctrine of loose grace. How about this one? About the false doctrine that says morality is optional. And I'll give an example. This week at your favorite convention, the Democratic National Convention, a woman stood on stage and gloried in the fact that when she was a young lady, she had had an abortion because at that time a baby was inconvenient. And they gave her a standing ovation. That's not the God that I serve or the country that I pledge loyalty to. The problem is, it's not okay. It is what it is at the Democratic Convention, but it's creeped itself into the church. And I'm not on a political soapbox, and I don't even really know what a soapbox looks like. But I will say this, if you vote for that, God have mercy on your soul. How do these false doctrines come in? What are the avenues? We see the actual doctrines. What are the avenues? By the way, this is what he's talking about in verse 1. Therefore, we ought to give more heed, earnest heed to the things which you've heard. You got to give earnest heed to the truth because false doctrines are going to come in. How do they come in? Two ways in the scriptures, false prophets. People that start teaching our kids in junior church or teaching people in a Sunday school class or people that you would even allow stand behind a pulpit and they begin to say things that are a little bit edgy, but they're definitely not biblical. And as Jude said, it's scary that they can even slip in unawares. They can sneak right in. But I would also say it comes through, in some cases, organized religion. Wasn't it ironic that that's who Jesus went after? Like in Luke chapter 12, verse 1, when he said, in the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch they trod one upon another. I mean, they were stacking them one upon another to hear Jesus. He began to say to his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. I give you warning today, church. Beware of the undertow of false doctrine. Beware what you allow your mind to think. And beware of who you allow to speak into your life. But the second and final undertow that I will give to you this morning. Beware of the undertow of hidden sin. Beware. He says here in our passage, verse 2, he says, for if the word spoken by the angel was steadfast, and what he's doing, he's saying that this written word is just as strong as if the angels had come and spoken. If what they told the prophets was steadfast and true, this written word is steadfast and true. Jesus Christ is steadfast and true. He said, for if the word spoken by the angel was steadfast, and what did he say? That every transgression and disobedience will receive a just recompense. So just, the Bible says, that how shall we escape? Verse 3, if we neglect so great a salvation. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, what is sweeping people away from the anchor of Jesus Christ is false doctrine. But if it's not false doctrine, it's hidden or unconfessed sin in their life. We'll go back to Wednesday night. By the way, we went to church on Wednesday night. If you were here, you know it. And we talked about having an old-fashioned visitation from God. We're preaching through the book of Acts right now. And how that's what our country needs, is an old-fashioned visitation from Almighty God. And so I got everybody set up. I said, you want God to show up? How many of you want God to show up? Say amen. But when God shows up, there's some things that happen. And let me tell you the first thing that happens, Acts chapter 5. Sin is exposed. And so then I ask the question, do we really want God to show up? Would you rather have God's revealing presence, or would you rather have your covering of your sin? So nobody knows. I'm telling you, you right now, and I don't know who I'm talking to. I may be talking to a gentleman here. I may be talking to a lady. I may be talking to a grandparent. I might be talking to a teenager. But there's people in this auditorium today that you don't even realize how far you've drifted away from God and what caused this drift. It was the undertow of your hidden sin. The sin you don't think anybody knows about. God knows about it. Achan had hidden those treasures that he was not supposed to touch under his tent. And nobody, Joshua didn't know about it. But guess what? God did. David spent weeks trying to cover his sin with Bathsheba. Found out she was pregnant. They had committed adultery. He went and got Uriah, her husband, off the battlefield. Uriah had more integrity drunk than David did sober. David carried an order out to the captain of his guard. You put Uriah on the front lines. You pull your troops back. Make sure he's dead. I want my sin covered. And his sin might have been covered from the entire kingdom, but it was not covered from the true king. And some of you right now, you're wondering why you can't get back to shore. You're wondering why you used to have an intimate relationship with God and now it's falling apart. I'm telling you, you are being pulled away by your hidden sin, your transgression and your disobedience, which will have a just recompense. James chapter 1. Go there quickly. It's just a few pages over. James chapter 1, verse 12, the Bible says this. Blessed is the man that endureth. Chapter 1, verse 12, endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But notice this, but every man, verse 14, is tempted when he is drawn away by his own lust. When he's drawn away with his own lust and enticed, and then when lust hath conceived, it bring forth sin, and when sin is finished, it bring forth death. See, Satan won't tell you that. Satan will tell you sin's good, but the Bible says sin is death. Then verse 16, he says, do not err, my beloved brethren. Did you see the undertow of your lust that you won't deal with? Did you see the undertow of your bitterness that you've been holding on to for years? Have you seen do you see the undertow of the dishonesty that you've administered to your boss for the last few months? Do you see the undertow of the unfaithfulness that you have with your spouse? Do you see the undertow of your sin? The undertow is dangerous. I was reading this week, came across a story. What stuck out to me was the fact the story was actually written, the news article. It's not even in digital form. It's just a picture of a news article on Google, and you can look it up. What stood out to me was the story was just 2 months before I was born. When this story was written, I had not yet discovered America. But the story read, the residents of Galveston Island know the dangers of the vicious undertow on the island's southern tip. The article said on June 16th, 1978,
I know I look young for a 78 baby. On June 16, 1978, five visiting children, none of which could swim, ignored the many warning signs and waded into the fierce waters and were caught by the undertow. The reporter says, as horrified onlookers stood helplessly on the shore, they saw these five children swept to their deaths because they ignored the warning. Today I give you a warning. My mom and dad are here. Growing up, every day I had warnings. Today, as your pastor, I give you a warning. Beware of the undertow. Beware of drifting away from God. Because it can happen like that. As verse 3 says, you can get so far that there's no escape. Beware. Father, I pray that you would add anointing to your word as we contemplate these matters in our own heart. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and nobody looking around. Those that are getting baptized are just kind of making their way out. But this is serious time with God. Right now, you remember what I asked you to do? Humbly and honestly, allow the Holy Spirit to do His work. You're here today and you say, Pastor, I hear the warning. I don't want to drift. I don't want to drift away from the security of Christ. I want to heed the warning today. See, you're here right now. Listen to me. And you're not near as on fire as you used to be. You don't have the burden for souls like you used to have. You don't read your Bible as much as you used to. You don't pray. Or at least not as much as you used to. See, if we would look at that with our eyes wide open, we will realize today we've drifted. And today is a call to come back. Come back from your drifting. With God's help, overcome the undertow. Confess your sin. Put away your false doctrine. Earnestly approach the throne. You're here today and you'd say, Pastor, please pray for me. I don't want to drift away from God. I'm ready to come back to the shore. If that's you, would you lift up your hand this morning? Pastor, pray for me. God spoke to my heart this morning. Keep it up. This is what I want you to do. If your hand's up, I want us all to stand to our feet. And those with their hands lifted, I want you to leave your seat right now. Everybody standing. If God spoke to your heart, I want you to leave your seat right now. Join these and get around this altar. And I want you to ask God to keep you from drifting. Humbly today. Honestly today. Grandparent, teenager, mom, dad, doesn't matter. You need to do business with God. you come.
You need to come to the altar. It's still open. Folks are still making their way down. Time of prayer, time of reflection. Father, it's an awesome privilege to be able to come and with a broken heart and a contrite spirit and lay our burden down before you. And Lord, when we failed you, when we've sinned, when we've swayed away, when we've allowed the undertow, as the pastor has said, of life to cause us to slip away, it's so awesome and refreshing and such a privilege to know that when you prick our heart, when you compel us to come, that Lord, you're there with open arms to forgive us, to show your mercy, to show your grace and kindness, long-suffering. And Father, today I pray for these that have come. I pray for those, Lord, in the pew who are praying right now, whatever the concern, whatever the need, whatever the circumstance. Father, I pray today that you will fill them with your Spirit. I pray today, Lord, that you will hear their prayer, forgive. I pray, Lord, that your will be done. But Father, most of all, I pray this morning for those who may be fighting, who may be resisting the knocking at the door. Father, today I pray in love that you will continue to minister, that you will continue to compel, that you will continue to prick their heart as only you can. And Father, they will come to you. They will lay their burdens down before you. They will ask for forgiveness, whether it be for sin, salvation, or whether it be for repentance and coming out of a backslidden state. Father, I pray that your will be done. Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for this message. Thank you for how applicable it is to all of us this morning in our walk and in our Christian testimony. Father, you're so good. You're so merciful. You're so kind. And Lord, we give you praise and glory for who you are and what you are doing and what you are going to do for us in the future. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with this baptism service. Thank you for each one, Father, who has come, who wants to make a public profession of faith, to follow your example in baptism. God, we pray that you will strengthen them. We pray, Lord, that we will find strength in their act of open walk with you. Thank you again for your love and grace in the message today. In Jesus' precious name we do pray. Amen. Amen. As folks are making their way back to their seat, we'll go into our baptism service in just a moment. If you will have a seat, and we will prepare to go into that. Do remember a couple of announcements that are coming up. We do want to make sure about God's Man. We want to make sure we mention that. All right, that's this coming weekend, the 5th and the 6th. If you have not registered, please, please do so. I am going to draw a name. You ready? I'm going to draw a name. Here we go. I didn't draw two, I drew one. Ray Clark. There it is, right there. Brother Ray, he wins the drawing. All right, so we know what that is. Draw one more. Let me get Ray's out of the way so I don't draw him again. Huh? Let's draw one more. Here we go. Who is this? Jim Moore. Mr. Jim was in church this morning. I think he came to early service. So Mr. Jim and Mr. Ray are the winners of our drawing. Okay, so God's Man coming up this weekend. Don't forget about that. also evening service tonight, all right? And I'll share more announcements in just a moment, but I think he's ready. All right.
All right. Well, again, thank you for being here. And we have, I believe, 9 young people that are going to get baptized this morning. And I've been able to sit down with each one of them and talk to them about getting saved, to talk to them about knowing what it means to be saved and what baptism is. And I just want to reiterate to everyone here, baptism is not so that you can be more saved. Baptism is something that you do after you get saved. But it's also an act of obedience. We've been commanded. Jesus commanded baptism. Peter commanded baptism. The Apostle Paul. The Word of God commands believers to be baptized. And what's awesome about today is we have 9 young people that want to follow the Lord in believer's baptism. And so we're going to do something a little bit different because we have so many. We're going to just pray one time and just ask God's blessing on each one of them. We want to thank the Lord for each one of them, their families, their salvation. I remember the story when D.L. Moody came home from an evangelistic event, and his wife asked how many got saved. And he said, well, 2.5. And the wife said, so 2 adults and 1 kid got saved. He said, no, 2 kids and 1 adult, because the adult only has half their life left. The kid has their entire life ahead of them. And I'm glad that we get to baptize 9 full life young people that they can dedicate the rest of their days to Jesus Christ. So let's pray. Would you bow with me? And let's ask the Lord's blessing on this baptism. Father, thank you for the young people that we get the privilege to baptize today. Lord, thank you that we as Christians have been buried in the likeness of your death. And Lord, as we come out of these waters, it's a picture that we have been raised in the likeness of your resurrection. Lord, thank you for saving my soul. Lord, thank you for saving these young people that now they have, Lord, many years, if you tarry your coming, to live for you, to change the globe with the gospel. So, Lord, I pray that you would be honored today as we baptize these amazing young people. Thank you for their families. In Jesus' name we pray. This is Andy Simmons. Wild Man Andy. Listen, we have seen this young man grow, mature. He's got a lot of his mom and daddy, the good parts in him. James and Anna are wonderful parts of our church. And I've seen Andy come out here with his dad, work surveying the field, help clean out stuff. He's an outdoorsman, he loves to be outside. But talking to him this week, he's nailed it down in his heart. He knows Jesus Christ as his Savior, and he wants to be baptized. And so we're honored that some of his family's here. We're honored to baptize him today. Andy, based upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. She's got a pretty impressive doctrinal statement that she understands what it means to be saved. And she understands what this is. This is a picture of what Jesus Christ did in our hearts and in our lives when we got saved. And so as a proud daddy, I'm honored today to baptize my precious little girl. Okay? Caden, based upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son. Thank you. stand, and let me encourage you, and this is probably the first time I've ever said this, let me encourage you to be back for our business meeting tonight, all right? We're going to be casting some vision. I promise the meeting will not be boring, and then after our business meeting, we have our ministry fair, so if you're new to our church and you want to get plugged in, you want God to use you here at New Life, tonight's the night to be back, okay? We love you. Bruce, dismiss us if you will.
Awesome to see everybody getting baptized. Love to see kids getting baptized. That's great. Thank you so much for being here. Again, come back for our evening service. Remind the choir for choir practice this afternoon at 4:45, praise team, 4:30 for run through, okay? Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for the awesome privilege to worship you in your house. Thank you for these great kids. Thank you for the baptism today. And, Lord, what an encouragement it is. Dismiss us now in your love and care. Bring us back again tonight for another service. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. God bless. See you tonight.